Whiskey Jason here, whiskey from the viewpoint of an American over here in Germany, often tasting rare and exotic whiskeys. I have something from Elsburn, a distillery I really like. Used to be called Glen Els. They decided not to fight the SWA and just change the name. And this is their first, this is batch number one, Rivesaltes cask. This is a full maturation. 1,484 bottles, 46%, whiskey base number 230651. This originally had a price of €74.90, at least that was the recommended retail price. At the moment, where it's going down to 69, and maybe it'll even go down further, who knows. Now, Rivesaltes is a region in France, the Pyrenees. It is not a very well-known region for wines, but it is a vin du naturel, VDN. So if ever watched a video with me about Waterford Distillery in Ireland, you will know that I hate VDN casks because it just means fortified wine, which Waterford categorize as, it could be a sherry, could be a port, could be a Zoltan, could be a Rivesaltes. And they say they're the same. At least they categorize them as the same. And for me, as a whiskey lover and connoisseur, no! All right, so Rivesaltes is a fortified wine, the southwestern part of France, very sweet, very interesting. Now, I do have, oh, let's pour something in my glass so we can talk about this for a second. I do have, for example, I think my first encounter with this was the following. So, 2 years ago, Tomaten had a, from 2008, a 12-year-old bottling. This was bottled on the 29th of March, 2021. It was distilled, recast in July of 2017. So this actually had almost 4 years, at least 3.5 years here of good time in these fortified French wine casks, Rivesaltes. And non-chilled filtered, natural color, 46%. What else does the world need here? Well, to be very, very honest, it needs casks that are not sulfured. So this is my only big, big, big problem with this. I'm gonna put the box over here. This bottling. The casks had a sulfur candle in them, and from the south of France all the way to Scotland and all that sulfur actually was absorbed by the cask and gave it back to this distillate and just ruined this bottle for me, unfortunately. Now this doesn't have that much sulfur, luckily, I must admit. But the nose is a little bit shy, to be honest. It doesn't really, really pop out like I expected it to. Look at the color difference. This is 12 years of age. This is a no age statement. I'm going to say this is between 4 and 6 years of age here from Germany. This is 12 years of age. I had the feeling, and I'm going to stick with my gut feeling here. Tomaten basically said, okay, we have a batch of 12-year-old whiskey. It's not great. All right, let's just give it a finish and let's bottle it with 12 years of age then, and we'll see what we can do with that. I don't think they took their best cask and said, oh, let's take a look at these. These are perfectly matured and nice bourbon barrels. Now we're going to make them even better with a finish. I think they said, these are not going to develop in the direction we wanted them to. Third, fourth fill, hogshead, bourbon barrels. Let's give them a finish. Let's make it something special. And to be honest, it was a little bit special because they did make it a 12-year-old. There was three of them. A Zoltan cask, which was interesting, as well as here this Mont Basilic. I don't know if I ever will say that correctly or not. All these are French. Basically, are they all three fortified wines from France? Shows how much I remember from my own videos years ago. All right, now we're talking about this. This is a finish. This is a full maturation. And that makes this a little bit special. I don't know of anyone who has tried to do a full maturation ever. Now, I mentioned Waterford, VDN, their use of the casks. They know that I dislike their categorizing all these different types of fortified wines as VDN, but hey, they'll keep on doing it. That's fine. Now, Ned, the head master there, head distiller there, I visited him, 4 or 5 years ago. I was in his laboratory. He said, "Welcome to my spice rack." I was like, "Excuse me?" He said, "Here, my spice rack. I have all these different casks, and they're just like spices in the kitchen." And I loved that picture. Thank you, Ned, for that. I really did. Now, this is a spice I'm not very familiar with. Rivesaltes. This is a spice that I'm a little bit more familiar with. This is a full maturation, 5 years in an STR cask from King's Barn. This was way too overpowering. It was, if you were eating pure, 100% straight from the little jar that I have for my spices, thyme, or oregano, or even pure salt or pepper, or whatever you want. It was just too much. And a spice should normally not be consumed in its pure natural state. It's used as a little bit to actually, as almost like a catalyst to make something better. All right? And this is my problem with this bottle. This is way too much all by itself. All right? So I'm going to take a little sip here. It overpowered. I don't like this. I don't like this at all. I would give this a D. Now, what I did is I was like, wait, what's going on here? I don't understand. Why don't I like it? And it's like, it's almost like being at a rock concert and having, I don't know if you've ever been to like a festival. And if you are at a festival, you have a stage here, and you might have a stage there, and you might have a stage there. And if you have like three speakers for three different things happening at the same time, just going in your head, it's like, I don't understand anything. And that's what's happening here. It's like there's just too much going on at once. And so it's like, all right, I'm going to dilute it down. Now it's 46%. So I diluted it down to like 40%. It might have been 38. All right, so let's take a little sip. It's still amazingly packed together. It's a little bit less, but it's still. So I'm going to dilute it down to under 30% and see what happens here. Now the finish down here at around 35% where I was nice. It was peaches, apricots, blackberries. There's a very, very a sweet, syrupy moment going on here. A little bit of wood. It's like almost even raspberries in a corn syrup moment. There's a lot, but it's still too intensive for me. It might just be me, but it might be the whiskey as well. That's just too intensive. Too much happening and in too small space of room. So I've diluted it down. I've kind of distorted it a little bit, pulled it out from each other so I can actually enjoy, hopefully, this whiskey at a whole different area. This is no longer whiskey. It's way below, it's 25% alcohol, if even that. But there's a magnificent flavor profile going on here. That sulfur that I, a little bit that I had, a little bit of a burntness I had, all gone. This is just pure flavor, and it's a wonderful, wonderful flavor direction I like. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get rid of this for a second. I'm going to pull out something that you're going to go, wait a second, what's he doing? I'm going to pull out what I haven't done for, I think, years, a Glenmorangie 10. So, the Glenmorangie 10 is, for me, one of these whiskeys that I think, it's almost like a blank canvas. For me, the best blank canvas that I have at the moment is Glencadam 10, which I don't have available. So I'm just going to take the Glenmorangie 10. All right, so bourbon cask, matured usually. Not any really sherry influence here. Nothing that distorts or nothing that overpowers the palate. That's actually a very, very nice whiskey. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try the Glenmorangie 10, which I think is an awesome whiskey to introduce many, many people to the whiskey world, all right? So I would give them, if they're a Scotch drinker, I'd give them a Wild Turkey 101, Rare Breed, something like that. I'd say, here, that's what bourbon can do. And if they're usually a wine or beer drinker, I'd give them like something like a Glenmorangie. Say, try that, see if that's something you like. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to drink this. This is my baseline. Let's see if I get this right. Good. So this was my glass for the Rivesalt from Elsburn. I've added 3 drops. And this is for me basically almost like a finishing cask. All right, so I've added the amount, the influence of Rivesalt that I want to my Glenmorangie. Is it a blended? Is it a blended Scotch? No. This is German whiskey. This is single malt Scotch. Is it still hopefully emphasizing what I'm trying to show you? Yes. It's trying to show you that this would be awesome as a finishing cask in a much less intensive, concentrated manner. This was way too, for me, for my simple little taste buds, way too much. All right, let's try this. Glenmorangie, as I know and like. Nothing special, but very, very approachable. Now over here, the same Glenmorangie with a few drops of this. So I have a Rivesalt finish experience. It's not a finish, but it's an experience, all right? So on the nose, yes. That peaches, a little bit of peaches and cream, tiny little bit of peaches, cream, and maybe a little bit of raspberry. Let's call it raspberry syrup on there. To be honest, much more enjoyable than this. It adds depth, complexity, and a little bit more of a flavor profile that I enjoy. But this 100% full maturation pure is like drinking or like eating spices directly from the box. Spices should be well dosed without an overdosing, man, overdose. And this is for me an overdose, all right? So this is a D whiskey. This is from the price, 74 euros. I don't know. But if I use this whiskey as to spice up my life, to spice up my boring whiskeys, just put a little couple drops in there and see what happens, this could be a magnificent spice. So if I need Rivesalt, I know what I have. If I need STR, shave toasted recharred, usually Portuguese wine cask, I know what I have. If I want a good sherry, I can actually go to my cabinet, my spirits cabinet, my wine cabinet. I can pull out a sherry, I can pull out a port, I can pour a little bit in there and see what happens. Those are fabulous, fabulous possibilities there. And I do that every once in a while. It's like, oh, that's an okay whiskey. Let's spice it up a little bit. Let's put a little bit of port in there. Let's put a little bit of sherry in there. Let's put a little bit of Rivesalt in there. Let's put a little bit of STR in there. Oh, that's nice. And that's what this whiskey at the moment is being used for by me. Is it the original intention? No. Did it show me how whiskey, let's get rid of this, how Rivesalt matured whiskey could be? Yes. Did it overdo it? Definitely. This is overkill, all right? But it is much better than if I go back here to the Tomaten, bring this back here instead of the Glenmorangie, because this has too much sulfur in it. This just, the sulfur kills me. On the nose, on the palate, absolutely not what I like. Okay, Whiskey Jason here, question of the day. 2, as usual at the moment, Rivesalt. What other brands do you know? I know Irish Whiskey, Clonakilty did one. I know Tomaten did one. Germany did one with Elsburn. Who else is doing Rivesalt? And the second question is, what other whiskies have you had that have been perfectly suitable as a spice, so concentrated that you have to dilute them down with other whiskies to make them enjoyable, and not really suitable as a product itself? Interesting, if you go to the whiskey base here, whiskey base number 230651, the first comment is from Wilt Chamberlain. He writes down here, this has nothing, this has little to do with whiskey. And he just gave it 79 points. All right, the next person gave it 89 points. They loved it. And the next person gave it a 70. This is something where people are like either yeah or nah. And I'm more in that area of nah, but now I know why. And that's why I really enjoy whiskey, is to figure things out and to figure out what I dislike, why I dislike, and how to make it something that could be enjoyable for others. Thank you very much for watching, liking, subscribing, and telling others. See you real soon. Rivesalt is amazingly different. Bye-bye.